I'm Mr. Ananda Dhanasekaran. I am a urology consultant working in Sandwell and West Birmingham NHS Trust. Our trust consists of predominantly two hospitals, Sandwell General Hospital and City Hospital. I am very sure some of you will be having some postings at one point with us either side. I will be grateful if all of you please mute your mics. Thank you, because we have 98 people online, so even if one person is not appropriately muted, it can cause a disturbance. I can see chat box and somebody asking about the attendance code. I'm not sure about that. Possibly Dr. Brain will explain to you that later. Thank you. Okay, no worries. Dr. Brain, somebody asking about attendance code? Okay, that's good. And a kind of a housekeeping. This is a very friendly session. The session is not aimed at teaching. The session is aimed at learning. So what I mean is, I wish you guys to get the maximum out of this session. I have shared the whole PowerPoint with Dr. Brain. It will be available in your Canvas anytime. Those who are good in four-wall learning, I am sure they can make the best out of this PowerPoint slide and also use some additional learning with the other books and materials available in the Canvas. This session, I will try to go on a good pace so that you guys have the good understanding of various urology symptoms and presentations. Feel free to stop at any time. Please do not chat in the chat box. I'm not going to look into that. I'm happy for you guys to unmute and talk to me straight away. I'm happy for you guys to stop me at any point. I don't feel interrupted, so I'm quite happy to take it at your speed. Okay? So for most of you, you know what is urology. Urology consists of almost a third of all the surgical admissions if you are working on a urology register on call or any on call day. Urological symptoms, because of the peculiar nature of the organs, the impact is very high, and we have some diseases which are quite life threatening also. Urology treatment requires multidisciplinary interactions, and we have plenty of innovative technology advancement in place. If you have a good idea of physiology and anatomy, it will really help in management of the urology diseases. As you can understand, the urology epithelium starts all the way from pelvic callosal system up to the urethral meatus. The urothelial layer is 3 to 5 layers thick. It is quite impervious to urine, which means it's like watertight. And urinary carcinogens like smoking related carcinogens and aniline dye and various chemicals are the main reasons for the cancer in the urothelial epithelium. Kidney helps in continuous production of urine. Normally, urine is sterile. It has a unidirectional flow from top to bottom. Any stagnation, reflux, and UTI results in infection. Somebody has asked, if we are in a crowded area, it might be less disruptive to type a question. I'm happy for typing, but I need to look into the chat box. That's the only thing. Feel free to type. If I am not answering your question, please feel free to unmute and talk also. I agree. This is the curriculum for the urology teaching, and as you can see, the predominance is on history taking, hematuria evaluation, renal colic, that is the pain evaluation, examination of the genitalia, abdomen and DRE, and procedural curriculum mainly is digital rectal examination and urethral catheterization. This curriculum is not for year 3, so don't get overburdened on seeing this, or year 2. This is the curriculum for the whole till you reach the 5th year. So things will happen gradually. You will be exposed to all the examination and procedural skills as day goes on. So the main topics which are more important before you finish your medical school are uro-oncology, UTI, stones, erectile dysfunction, imaging, special investigations. Urinary tract obstruction is very important topic, whether it's a lower tract or upper tract. This is, I think, one of the important nutshell of the whole presentation and the whole curriculum, what you need to do, what you need to know. So on the first column, you can see various symptoms. The middle column shows the relevant knowledge, and the rightmost column shows the relevant possible diagnosis. So for example, if I take the first line, LUTS, which stands for lower urinary tract symptoms, the knowledge you need to know is maturation cycle and pharmacology, and relevant diagnosis possible out of this are OAB, which is overactive bladder, and BPH, which is benign prostatic hypertrophy. So like that, we can just, if you keep this one as like a flashcard and try to know about every term in this particular slide, that will help you to complete the full urology curriculum. Okay, there are 7 steps to diagnosis. I mean, these steps can be applied for any specialty, not peculiar to urology, but urology has some specific reasons in that. History, physical examination, basic and specialist investigation, imaging. So this is almost common to all the specialties, while endoscopy and biopsy forms a predominant part of the urology diagnosis. You should know the background knowledge in embryology, anatomy, physiology, which consists of bladder cycle and maturation cycle, and various risk factors for the diseases. I'm not going to take you much into the physiology and anatomy of the system, but as you all know, where the kidney is placed in the retroperitoneal organ, and the blood supply is directly from the aorta by the renal artery, and blood is taken away by the renal vein directly draining into IVC. And the ureter starts from the renal pelvis, descends all the way up to the bladder, joining the bladder at vesico-urethral junction. I'm not going to concentrate into anatomy and physiology. Hopefully you guys are already quite strong in it, and we can touch upon when we discuss the individual diseases. So the first clinical diagnosis we are discussing is LUTS, which is an abbreviation for lower urinary tract symptoms. In total, LUTS is divided into storage symptoms and voiding symptoms. Storage symptoms consist of daytime frequency, nighttime frequency, urgency, and incontinence. The terminologies are quite self-explanatory. At any point, any terminology is not clear, feel free to stop me. So day frequency means frequently visiting the toilet to pass urine in the daytime. Nighttime frequency means getting up in the night to pass urine. If someone is getting up more than once, that is nighttime frequency. And if somebody is very interested to learn in depth, if a man is disturbed by a sound or by any source, like maybe somebody sleeping next to him may have woken him up or something like that, and then he wakes up, just because he wakes up, he goes to the toilet to empty the bladder, that is not counted as nighttime frequency. So nighttime frequency is the one where the man or woman woken up because of the sensation to pass urine. So it's very important to make this differentiation. Urgency is inability to delay visiting the toilet when somebody has the sensation to pass urine. So normally, when someone has a sensation to pass urine, they can hold on maybe for 30 minutes, even for an hour, and find a good place to empty the bladder. Urgency is a symptom where a person needs to really rush to the toilet. Incontinence is the urine leak, which can happen in the form of urge incontinence, stress incontinence, overflow incontinence, or anatomical incontinence. Urge incontinence means when the patient had urgency at the time before going to the toilet, if there is a leak, that is urge incontinence. Stress incontinence means there is nothing urgent, patient is comfortable, but whenever he or she laughs, coughs, whenever there is an increased intra-abdominal pressure, it results in urine leakage. Overflow incontinence is much more dangerous. It happens because of the bladder getting overfilled without giving patient a stimulus to empty the bladder. It results in overflow incontinence. Anatomical incontinence is the one where patients have some anatomical problems like vesico-vaginal fistula or uretro-vaginal fistula, where because of the fistula, the urine is leaking outside. So these are the storage symptoms. Storage symptoms happens during the storage phase of the bladder. Coming to the voiding symptoms, it happens whenever a man or woman is passing urine. So at the time when he or she passing urine, so the symptoms are hesitancy, poor stream, terminal dripping, and post-maturation dribbling. The terminology is quite self-explanatory. Hesitancy means the urine is not flowing comfortably, it just stops and starts. Poor stream, or can be also called as weak stream. Terminal dribbling is the one where in the end of the urination there is some dribbling, and post-micturation dribbling is the one where patient completed passing urine but still feels that there is some residual urine which is dribbling out. This slide is predominantly for somebody who wants to have a bit of an advanced learning. It shows the micturation cycle. So there is a storage phase and there is a emptying phase, also called as voiding phase. And in the storage phase, as you can see here, the bladder is getting filled up, the first sensation to pass urine, the normal void to disappear, and then as the bladder emptied, the bladder is filling again. So this is known as micturation cycle. And the lower boxes explain exactly what happens during the respective micturation cycle. I don't think at this level you need to know all these things, but this is a good advanced learning which will help you to tackle some difficult questions both in the exams, whether it's OSCE or MCQ. So I will keep this for maybe a later year, year 4 if not year 5, but nothing wrong in learning at early stage. How will you evaluate a patient's LUTS? We can take some symptom questionnaire, midstream urine testing, measurement of the urea and creatinine or electrolytes in the bloods, PSA if needed, bladder scan, frequency volume chart, and optional testings are flow rate, plain X-ray KUB, ultrasound of renal tract, urodynamics, and cystoscopy. This is an example of the IPSS scoring sheet we use in our day-to-day practice. So as you can see, there are total of 7 symptoms in this first column. They are measured from 0 to 5 based upon how frequently they occur, and the total score will be maximum 35. So 35 is the maximum score through which it was done. Okay, somebody asked what was PSA for assessing LUTS. PSA stands for prostate specific antigen. It is a very specific test to make sure that there is no disease happening in the prostate. It's a blood test. The normal value for your point of view, we can take it as 4, number 4. So whenever a patient had PSA more than 4, it is abnormal. Less than 4, it's normal. But there is an age specific prostate value for every age. For example, those who are at the age of 70 to 80, the normal value reaches up to 6.5. And patients above 80, we even treat PSA values like 10 or 15 in a very conservative manner. Once the PSA reaches 20, the chances of prostate cancer, possibly a metastatic prostate cancer, is very high. That's where the importance of metastasis comes into play. So in summary, PSA stands for prostate specific antigen. It's a blood test. It's a very good screening tool to know whether there is any cancer happening, and also it will help in diagnosing the benign prostate also. So this is the IPSS score. Next is the examination. During examination, we need to examine for any suprapubic tenderness. Is there any palpable bladder? How consistent is the abdomen? What is the shape of the abdomen? And what are all the abnormalities? genital examination, digital rectal examination, and vaginal examination. This flow rate I will take with a pinch of salt for your level. This is a quite a high level question. When a man or woman passes urine, it will be marked here. So for example, this is an example of a normal man passing urine in a very good high stream. The peak flow rate is around like 20 ml per second and he emptied the urination appropriately. And this is an example for a man who has obstruction due to the BPH, where the voiding is prolonged and also it's quite intermittent. Okay, so the purple one is the normal while the green one is abnormal. What are all the causes of a patient having voiding dysfunction? So as I said, predominantly we have a filling phase and the voiding phase. So voiding dysfunction can happen due to UTI, overactive bladder, bladder outlet obstruction, bladder cancer, prostate cancer, gynecological problems, bladder stones and fistulas. So various things can cause voiding dysfunction. This diagram explains us how the BPH can impact a man's life. So this is the normal prostate gland, possibly slightly increasing in size from the normal level. And then as the prostate increases, you can see that the central prostatic urethra is also getting squeezed out. And because of this, it causes obstruction. The obstruction causes secondary changes in the bladder. If you see here, the bladder is quite normal, but here you can see that the bladder wall is nicely thickened. It caused some diverticulum, and also it can cause secondary stones due to urinary stasis. So these are all the changes due to advanced BPH. So BPH is a very progressive disease. It can start from very small gland to a quite big gland, causing obstruction to the bladder outlet. Management of LUTS, conservative treatment is important. By conservative, we mean we need to remove bladder irritants like coffee, tea from the patient's food habit. Medical therapy is by alpha blockers or 5-alpha reductase inhibitors and another group of drugs known as anticholinergic. I don't think they will ask you anything more than what is given in this slide. I don't think you need to know what type of alpha blocker drugs and what type of anticholinergic. If you can remember the main group, like what it is given here, that's more than enough. Surgical treatment, various type of treatments available. Those who are had the postings to attend the hospitals, possibly by year 3 or year 4, you will be frequently seeing TURP surgery, green light, urolift, resume, or the various surgical options for prostate. Again, you will be only asked to know the surgical options name. Urinary incontinence, as I said, the incontinence can happen due to overflow incontinence, stress incontinence, or urge incontinence. It is nicely demonstrated in the pictures here. So, a patient's genuine stress incontinence is due to congenital weakness of the bladder neck or denervation of the sphincter mechanism of the pelvic floor. It can happen after a vaginal delivery, estrogen deficiency in menopause. And incontinence can happen also due to detrusor instability, retention with overflow incontinence, urogenital fistula, temporary urinary infections, or medications. Urethral diverticulum can cause incontinence. So predominantly you need to know only the types of incontinence and possible reasons for incontinence. Again, in this whole presentation, there will be 5 to 6 slides which are for people who are interested in a bit of an advanced learning. So this is a kind of advanced learning by which we are explaining complex histometry. So patient will have a tube passed through the urethra into the bladder. So it's maybe a single tube or 2 tubes. This will measure the pressure in the bladder and also it will help to pass water into the bladder. This results in physiological filling of the bladder, and there is a separate tube in the rectum or vagina to measure the pressure of the abdomen. So in women we can keep it in the vagina, but in men it will be in the rectum. There are some electric probes which will tell about the pelvic muscles. Overall, this will help us to know how good the patient's bladder is filling up and how good patient is able to have the pressure in the bladder is working and how much the patient is able to empty the bladder. So this is known as cystometry. I am sure this is not necessary for you at this level, but it will be very useful if you understand that there is an advanced test available. Yeah, there is a question, why do alpha blockers cause incontinence? So alpha blockers result in relaxation of the prostate and bladder neck. If a patient has already a weak bladder neck, if they are taking medicines which will relax the bladder neck further, it can cause incontinence. But for the reasons of incontinence, you need to mention alpha blocker as a very, very last reasons. It's not one of the commonest reason. The other commonest reasons we have discussed before. How will you manage a urinary incontinence? Again, any management starts with conservative management, because patient may have some lifestyle changes which needs to be followed, like excess of alcohol or quitting smoking or cutting down the caffeinated drinks. So these are all presented in the conservative management. And a urethral catheter is a good choice for overflow incontinence, because patient has incontinence because of absence of bladder emptying. If they have a catheter, that will help to empty the bladder, and that is the best choice for overflow incontinence. For any incontinence due to the bladder, like urge incontinence, anticholinergics are very good medications. And on later stage for stress incontinence, we have surgical steps like plugs, bulking agents, artificial sphincters, etc. If there is any anatomical cause like vesicovaginal fistula, patient needs appropriate surgery for vesicovaginal fistula or urethrovaginal fistula repair. Okay, so I got these kind of discussion time questions 5 to 6 times in the whole series. I'm quite happy if somebody needs to unmute and ask any questions. If not, we will continue. Okay, I will take that you guys got the good information from the first session. Let us continue with the second session, hematuria. Hematuria is divided into visible hematuria and non-visible hematuria. Visible hematuria means a patient is able to see blood in the urine. It is simply known as visible hematuria. Those who are interested, the old terminology for this is macroscopic hematuria, but please don't use that anymore. Non-visible hematuria is the one where patient never saw any blood in the urine, but when the blood is checked using a dipstick. Dipstick is the test where there is a strip. When it is dipped into the urine containing pot, the color of the strip will change to show the presence of blood. The strip has multiple values. We can deduct hematuria, presence of pyuria, leukocytes, pH, specific gravity, ketones. We can detect so many things in the strip. So that is non-visible hematuria. Non-visible hematuria, patients may be symptomatic or asymptomatic. As you can easily guess, visible hematuria is more significant. Symptomatic non-visible hematuria is next significant, and asymptomatic non-visible hematuria is least significant. Investigations for hematuria almost follows the same pattern like LUTS, full blood count, UNEs, MSU. In addition to the normal ones, we can send the urine for cytology. Urine cytology means we are sending the urine sample to a pathology lab. They will spin the urine and take some cells to see is there any chance of cancers happening in the urine. And we can also do the blood test for PSA. For patients with visible hematuria, CT erogram is the investigation of choice. We will give contrast, and contrast will delineate the kidneys, ureters, bladder quite clearly. Other images commonly used are ultrasound, retrograde pyelogram, in which we'll give some contrast into the ureter from low to up, MRI scans. Endoscopy can be like a flexible cystoscopy or rigid cystoscopy, and rarely biopsy is needed. So these are all the investigations for hematuria. So this is a picture of a flexible cystoscopy. So what this doctor is holding is the cystoscope. He is eyeballing and examining through the cystoscope. Nowadays we connect this to a camera, and camera is connected to a STAC system, so we can see the STAC system, and patient is having this flexible cystoscopy done. The water is used for irrigation, and this is the one which takes the light into the flexible cystoscope. You can see the patient is awake. It's not a very painful procedure. And during the flexible cystoscopy, we can end up finding the features like this. This is a typical transitional cell carcinoma of the bladder, and this is the ureteric orifice. So the tumor is just above the ureteric orifice. We can say this tumor is nicely papillary in growth, and maybe like 1 or 1.5 centimeters. So this is the surgery. Once the patient is put to sleep, we use the TUR loop to resect the tumor in bits. Our aim is to resect it completely so that we are taking even the muscle samples. Depending upon the invasion of the tumor into the wall of the bladder, it is divided into PTA, which means very superficial, PT1, it involves up to the lamina propria, PT2 involves up to the muscle, PT3 goes to the extravesical space, PT4 involves the surrounding structures like prostate, seminal vesicle, etc. And for low risk tumors, TURBT is nothing but transurethral resection of bladder tumor. Apart from that, we can give some chemotherapy in the form of mitomycin. For the medium risk, we will do TURBT plus we'll give 6 cycles of mitomycin. For high risk patients, we give BCG. So BCG and mitomycin are two different types of medicines given into the bladder. Mitomycin is a kind of chemotherapy, while BCG is a kind of immunotherapy. Immunotherapy means anything given to a man or woman which stimulates the immune reaction in the patient's body. So BCG is a live attenuated vaccine, like the tuberculosis vaccine, which most of you may have when you are a child in your arm. And this BCG results in stimulation of the immune response of the patient's own body, resulting in clearing any non-visible tumor, and also it protects the future tumor recurrence and progression. If the patients are not responding to that, we need to plan for radical cystectomy. Radical cystectomy means removal of the bladder in total with surrounding soft tissues like peritoneum, etc. This is for the non-muscle invasive tumor. This is all first three is for the superficial tumors. If the patient has muscle invasive tumor, we need to plan for radical cystectomy or radiotherapy. I don't think you need to go anything more than what we are discussing here. Usually, if the patient is got a superficial cancer, 70% will remain superficial throughout the life and have excellent outcome, and 30% will become more invasive, and the outcome depends upon what treatment is offered. Those who have invasive bladder tumor, which means the tumor is invaded into the muscle, which means it is T2, they can have surgery, which is 5-year survival is 60%, and radiotherapy 5-year survival is approximately 40%. Next, we are discussing the renal cancer. So this ultrasound picture shows a mass in the kidney. It's a right kidney, and the patient can present with hematuria. The disease can be diagnosed by ultrasound or CT, and tumor could be a renal cell cancer, collecting system cancer like a TCC or RAR types. For evaluation of the renal cancers, we follow the same protocol. If there is a cystic solid, we can differentiate by using a CT scan, baseline renal function, any signs of advanced disease, any metastasis needs to be found out. This is the example of a resected specimen of the kidney, where you can see the tumor in the lower pole, and this is the upper pole of the kidney, and this is the renal pelvis. This is the CT picture, which shows the left kidney is completely replaced by the tumor. The opposite right kidney is normal. Any questions in the malignancy cancers? Sorry, my throat is playing up today. Hopefully we'll have a good discussion. Okay, next we are discussing the prostate cancer. And as one of you asked, PSA stands for prostatic specific antigen. It is a type of a protease enzyme secreted in the seminal fluid. It is predominantly secreted by the prostate but stored in the seminal fluid. And small amount gets into the bloodstream during the cell division. It is nicely bound to the plasma protein. It is increased during enlarged prostate, prostatitis, or CA prostate. So this picture shows how the prostate has prostatic ducts, which produces the PSA, which escapes into the blood vessels, resulting in the presence of the PSA in the blood. And once it is in the blood, it can present as a free PSA or bound to the proteins, which could be like a ACT or serum protein goblin. You don't have to remember more than a free PSA, a bound PSA. Those two are enough. As I told before, based upon the age, the PSA will be slightly increased, and free PSA is not that frequently measured. Usually we measure the total PSA. So this picture shows the age specific PSA, as I told you. So people 70 to 80, I took an example and told you that the PSA is 6.5 or above is abnormal. So prostate consists of various zones. So there is a prostatic urethra which is going in the center. Immediately surrounding the prostatic urethra is the periurethral gland, also known as central zone. On both sides is the transition zone. And at 12 o'clock area, we get the fibromuscular zone, and outside is the peripheral zone. So I don't think anybody will ask you to draw this diagram. The importance is the cancer always happens in the peripheral zone, and BPH always happens in the transition zone. That's the main take-home message. Prostate cancer is one of the commonly diagnosed cancer for men in UK. As you can see that as the patient get older, the cancer diagnosis is quite high in the 70s and 80s. And so it's one of the very commonest cancer we see in our practice. Prostate cancer patients present asymptomatic or just only with raised PSA. Sometimes they have abnormal digital rectal examination. They may present sometimes with urinary symptoms or backache or symptoms of metastasis, or symptoms of local progression. Symptoms of local progression means if the local prostate gland is increasing in size, it can cause pain and inflammation in the local area. So prostate cancer diagnosis by using the PSA. TRUST biopsy. TRUST stands for transrectal ultrasound biopsy. So we pass a scan probe through the back passage and then take biopsies from the prostate. This is the digital rectal examination, where we pass the finger into the prostate and measure the prostate size, shape, consistency, etc. So once you are attending the hospital postings, you will come across urologists doing digital rectal examination. And this is an example of how the prostate tissue is classified according to the histology differences. So if there is less difference, it is known as 1, and then 2, 3, 4, and 5. And this is scored as Gleason score. Gleason score is taken as two values. One of the commonest value is taken, and then the second commonest value is taken. Usually one is not that frequently reported, 1 and 2. So most of the cancers starts from 3. So 3, 4, 5 are the commonest cancers. And this is a bone scan where it shows some hot spots, which shows that the prostate cancer has spread to the bones. Okay. And this is the prostate biopsy where we pass the scan probe through the back passage and take some needles to take the biopsies of the prostate. Again, once you get the urology postings, you will have a chance to see the prostate biopsy being done. MRI is a very nice investigation to evaluate the prostate, and it can show the suspicious areas in the prostate. Any questions in the prostate cancer, feel free to type. What did you mean by 3, 4, 5 as in the commonest cancer? Okay, so I'll take back to the previous slide. I'll try to go back to that and then show you. Are you able to see the picture? Screenshot is lost, isn't it? Okay, I'll share again. Yeah, I'm doing it again. Now you can see. So what I mean by 3, 4, 5 means, if you see here, the prostate, the specimen is differentiated from least differentiated to very differentiated. So if the prostate glands are nicely differentiated and clumped together, it is Gleason 1. If there is a slight gap in between the cells, that is Gleason 2. If there is loss of shape, that is Gleason 3. If there is loss of architecture, that is Gleason 4. And if the prostate tissue is replaced by strands of malignant cells, that is Gleason 5. So 3, 4, 5, these are the only areas which is labeled as prostate cancer. If the biopsy shows Gleason 1, Gleason 2, it is not a prostate cancer. Again, the most important thing is there is no Gleason 1 and 2 separately. We always measure at least two grade. Usually it is reported as Gleason 3 plus 3, Gleason 3 plus 4. For example, if there is a good amount of prostate cancer and 3 is noted but 4 is not noted, much means it will be Gleason 3 plus 4. If the prostate is full of 4, means it is Gleason 4 plus 4. So in essence, the take-home message is Gleason 3, 4, 5 are important to be labeled as cancer, while Gleason 1 and 2 are not reported or they are not considered as a cancer. There are some more questions. What were the most important points about the anatomy of the zones of the prostate? Again, okay, I'll come back to that. How much PSA does these have to be for it to be abnormal? I think we have discussed the second point. So regarding the prostate, this is the value where it is age specific. I will say for medical students level, you can take cutoff as 4. So if anybody with less than 4 PSA, it is normal. More than 4, it is abnormal. But if you want to get more brownie points, it is age specific. So for every decade of age, there is a specific cutoff. The commonest cutoff which you can quote in the exam, easy to remember, is anybody more than 70 year old, the cutoff is 6.5. The person who devised this cutoff is known as Allstring. So you can also mention this name. This whole PowerPoint is prepared in a very detailed manner so that you will get more than what you're supposed to know. So don't get over exhausted in learning everything. That's why when presenting, I am very clear in explaining to what level you guys are expected to understand the system. I will come back to the zones in a few minutes. The NHS says about 3 to 4 men with a raised PSA level will not have cancer. If someone has a raised PSA, do you always send them for a biopsy? Okay. Most probably, if a patient has raised PSA, they will end up having biopsy. the doctor can do second PSA, nothing wrong in it. Mostly the GP will do the first PSA, and once they reach the urologist will do the second PSA. If there are two values which is showing an increase, then we need to go for biopsy. So hundreds of patients undergo biopsy under our care. But the reason why 3 out of 4 people are not having cancer is because the biopsy can come as normal, which is quite reassuring. But having said that, biopsy of the prostate by using the needle means we are really sampling certain extent of the peripheral zone alone. We are not removing the whole prostate. So a biopsy has got its own false negative value. False negative means in a test the value is negative, but it is false negative. Patient has cancer, but the test haven't found the cancer. That is false negative. So when it is false negative, we won't discharge the patient. We will do further PSA values, and we will measure the PSA velocity, which is the speed by which the PSA is rising. The normal cutoff for that is 0.75 ml per year. Again, this is quite high for your level, which shows that if the PSA is increasing beyond 0.75 ml per year, that means we need to be careful. Patient will have a second set of biopsies. So it is correct that 3 out of 4 men with increased PSA has no cancer, but they will follow the same protocol. I'll come to the zones again. So in this, you can clearly see that this is the urethra. Let us assume this is the bladder. The whole area here is the bladder. So the urethra goes and becomes a penile urethra. The gland which is very close to the urethra is known as periurethral gland. The kidney shaped glands on both sides is the transition zone, in which the normal benign hypertrophy happens. The outside peripheral zone, which is in the red, is the one where the usually the cancer happens. If you see in a cross section, it will be like a transition zone, and the peripheral zone will be outside. Peripheral zone is commonly affected by the cancer, while transition zone is commonly affected by the benign growth of the prostate. Okay, that's what we mentioned. Okay, this is the prostate biopsy, MRI, and this flowchart will again tell you about the various expected stages: pre-diagnosis, diagnosis, staging, by localized staging, locally advanced staging, and metastatic staging. So localized means we can keep the patient on watchful waiting. We can advise the patient radical prostatectomy, where the prostate gland is removed completely, or radiotherapy. We can monitor the patient after any procedure. In case of the locally advanced disease, there is a role for hormone treatment. Prostate cancer is a cancer which depends upon the presence of the hormones. So it is depending upon the male hormone. By hormone treatment, what we mean is we give injections which will reduce a man's male hormone, so that the prostate cancer has nothing to feed on and it will slowly shrink and decrease in its efficacy. When the cancer reaches into the other organs, we have seen one of the bone scan. It is known as metastatic cancer. It requires hormone manipulation, hormone escaped. Then after hormone manipulation, the disease can reach a stage of hormone escaped disease, and then finally it's only a palliative treatment. Any questions in the meantime on the prostate cancer? Okay, next we are going to the kidney stones. It creates one of the awful symptom, especially women can relate. Even the pain is almost equivalent to their labor pain or during the pregnancy. Extreme pain, cramps, frequent urge to urinate, nausea, vomiting, and sweating. So these are all the investigations. Usually the commonest investigation is a CT scan. We don't need ultrasound or the contrast CTs. So a normal CT scan is quite good to localize the stone here. You can see the stone here. And ultrasound can cause a stone with post acoustic shadow, where a stone is nicely demarcated. And this is the scan, a CT scan with contrast. which shows that there is an obstruction on the right side due to the presence of the stone, and the CT in a different angle showing the presence of the stone. And I've not dwelled much about the stone because it is not in your curriculum. So predominantly what you need to know is what are all the symptoms with which patient can present if a patient has stone, and what are all the investigations required for the patient with the stone, which we have covered. The another clinical scenario is the urinary retention. It can happen in acute or chronic. Acute means it's a painful retention, sometimes more than 1000 ml, and there is a good relief of pain with catheterization. Chronic retention, patient has usually no pain, the volume is more than 1000 ml. Sorry, for acute it is less than 1000 ml. Mostly, not necessarily every time, mostly. And in chronic retention, patient can have low pressure retention or high pressure retention. The pressure is if the patient has a retention, but it is low pressure, which means the pressure is nicely relaxed within the bladder. While in high pressure, the pressure is transmitted into the kidneys. Because of the back pressure effects, it is transmitted into the kidneys. High pressure chronic retention is much more significant because it can cause irreversible kidney damage. Management of the retention: check bloods before catheterization so that we will know what is happening. But in general, if the patient is quite symptomatic, we tend to catheterize them priority. And the type and size of the catheters: various catheters are available. Again, at this level, if you know that there is a need for catheter, that's more than enough. Record the residual urine. And if the patient has some evidence of renal failure, you need to monitor the output and keep a close eye. And we need to plan adequately when we are going to remove the catheter. Removal of the catheter is known as TVOC, which means trial void without catheter. Trial void without catheter. Or we need to plan for a definitive surgery. So this is how it looks when somebody has got a catheter. So bladder has got a catheter going through the urethra all the way into the bladder, and there is a Foley balloon which helps to keep the catheter in situ. And this is a suprapubic catheter where instead of going through the urethra, it is going through the anterior abdominal wall. Okay, these are all the examples for the catheterization. Any questions in catheter? Yeah, I got a question. Hormone therapy for prostate cancer. Yeah, you don't have to know exactly the hormone therapy for prostate cancer, but out of your interest, I can explain a little bit. As I said, prostate cancer depends upon a man's hormone. If I say a man's hormone, predominantly it is testosterone. So if we give an injection which will reduce a man's testosterone, that results in reduced uptake for the prostate. So it's like starving someone when someone needs a specific type of food. So if we are giving an injection which is known as LHRH agonist or LHRH antagonist, commonly given injection is LHRH agonist, which means luteinizing hormone agonist. When you give the injection, the patient's testosterone levels are reduced, which results in prostate not getting enough feed to thrive to become a metastatic one, results in shriveling of the prostate and death of the prostate cells. It won't cure the prostate disease, but it really helps to control the prostate disease and downsize the stage of the prostate cancer. So that is the hormone treatment. There's one more question there. How does one insert a catheter in a male? Is there a risk of piercing outside of the urethra? Yeah. Yes, injury to the urethra during catheterization is possible. That's why there is a specific training protocol available, and we need to follow the training protocol. We nicely lubricate the urethra with a lignocaine jelly. The jelly not only acts as a lubricant, it also causes as lignocaine. Lignocaine is a local anesthetic, and we need to pass the lignocaine. And the trick lies in a person's sensation or feedback in the hand. So when you are holding a man's penis and then passing the catheter, just by the feel you can say that you are in the correct lumen. If it is too tight, you are not supposed to force it out. So as long as it is going smoothly in your hand, you can be confident that it is entering the bladder. Once it entered the bladder, you can see the urine coming out, then you can fill the balloon to hold the Foley catheter in place, and you can remove the catheter a little bit outside so that it's nicely snugly fitting into the urethra. Catheterizing in women is slightly easier because of the short urethra, but sometimes in obese women, in elderly women, it has its own challenges to locate the urethral orifice. For your question, is there any possibility of urethral injury? Yes, there is a possibility of urethral injury, but it won't be as dramatic as you mentioned, like catheter entering the urethra and piercing outside. Not like that. For that, a man has to be really brutal in placing a catheter, or he's not using a flexible Foley catheter, he's using something like a metal wire to do that. It won't go like that, because it's a very, what we are using is a nicely flexible silicone catheters, so they won't do that type of damage. But a general urethral damage can happen, and then you may end up having a blockade, you're not able to pass the catheter any forward. Then you need to do a flexible hysteroscopy to look into the urethral passage and then keep a catheter on over that. Yeah, so urethral injury is possible. That's a good question. Next, we discuss about the scrotal lumps. Again, not a very detailed discussion needed for your level. We have just prepared this slide to make sure that you are able to create a nice differential diagnosis. So, is the scrotal lump is painful? If it is not painful, are you able to get above it? If you are able to get above the swelling, it means it is something to do with the testes. If you are not able to get above the swelling, it means it may be something like hernia. If you are able to get above the swelling, if it transilluminates, it could be like a hydrocele. If it is not transilluminating, it could be a tumor or it could be a varicocele. And epididymal cyst, if it is large enough, it can also nicely transilluminate. So patients may present with painful testicular lumps. They are testicular torsion, epididymoarchitis, or sometimes the strangulated hernia. These are the various differential diagnoses. What is transillumination? We can see that this picture explains the transillumination. Transillumination means examiner will keep a torch light below the swelling. If the swelling has a clear fluid, the torch light will go inside and it will illuminate the whole hydrocele sac. That is the transillumination principle. The transillumination can happen with any fluid filled organ, but commonly it is described for hydrocele, but it can happen with epididymal cyst also. Okay, so transillumination means a torch light is kept on one side of the swelling, and the light passes through that, and it is nicely seen as a transillumination. Very nicely we can demonstrate it in fair skinned individuals like Caucasian men. It's slightly difficult to demonstrate in African or colored skin men. And those who wants to do some advanced learning, there are some small topics on andrology, embryology, and renal failure. I think renal failure is nicely covered by the other medical specialists like a nephrologist. Embryology is always nice to learn, and I think you guys have already covered the embryology part. Andrology is a very small part. I don't think you need to know any further. After this slide, I've got another 3-4 slides which you can see in your canvas. That is must for somebody who wants to do any advanced learning. We complete our session from this, but I'm quite happy to stay for a few minutes to see if you have any questions. My main take home from this full learning program, full learning hour, is what is urology? What are all the subjects you are supposed to learn in urology? And what is the curriculum in the urology? From 2023, there will be new GMC MLA, which means Medical Literature Assessment Exams, which your year 5 students will be taking part. Also, there is a different curriculum which covers all the subjects, urology, gynecology. I have taken the subjects which are supposed to be covered in urology and covered it here. So as I mentioned before, if you know a little bit of whatever we discussed today, that's enough for year 2 and year 3. But by year 4, you should know everything what we have discussed today. Anything extra like advanced learning, which I added like 5 slides in the end of the presentation, is very good to get the extra brownie points. Next question is, thank you. That's good. I'm quite happy to discuss any other scenarios if you have any doubt. Let me see the chat box. Okay, guys. So, in summary, predominantly we are discussing the kidney stones, how kidney stone is presented, hematuria, microscopic and macroscopic, which is the old terminology, non-visible and visible is the newer terminology. What are all the implications of hematuria? How are we going to evaluate it? Malignancies, kidney cancers, predominantly by CT scans, and prostate cancer, predominantly by PSA test, prostate biopsy and MRI. Bladder cancer, predominantly by a flexible cystoscopy, urine examination and a CT scan, and various treatments for the bladder tumor like TURBT, which is a resection, and also radical cystectomy. What is the difference between visible and non-visible? Very simple. As I said, if a patient or doctor is able to see the blood in the urine, it is visible hematuria. So if the patient is passing a urine and collecting it in a bottle or a pot, if you are able to see red color in the urine, it is visible hematuria. If the urine looks clear or a bit cloudy, but when you test it by using the strip, if it shows the presence of the blood, it is non-visible hematuria. That is the main difference. Patients with visible hematuria has more chance of finding something significant, while non-visible hematuria, the chances are much less. Yeah. The causes may be almost same for both visible and non-visible. The only thing is, the causes are very significant. For example, a patient with visible hematuria has a chance of bladder cancer something around 30%, while patient with non-visible hematuria, the chances of cancer is only like 5% or 3%. Both the patients will have a camera test to examine the bladder, known as flexible cystoscopy. But in visible hematuria, we tend to do a CT scan so that we are evaluating the kidneys, ureters and bladder incomplete. While in non-visible hematuria, since the chances of cancer is so low, ultrasound is enough. So causes are same, but chances of finding the disease is high in visible hematuria compared to non-visible hematuria. Okay, good. So predominantly we have covered those main features by which the urology symptoms can present. Then in the end, we covered the various scrotal conditions also. Thank you, my pleasure. And when you are going through these slides, I'm sure you will have a recording of this also. So please try to go through the recording. And from now onwards, we will try as much as possible, not just giving the slides. We will also give an up-to-date, nice voiceover recording so that it's easy for people to revise, and the subtitles will be available, transcription will be available for those who need the transcriptions. Good. Any other questions before we conclude? Very good. If there is no further questions, we will complete it now. And welcome to City Hospital or Samuel Hospital. And I'm quite happy to have you as a student in the urology department.